Hobby and Liz, everybody's here. Everybody say hi.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
We miss you.
Good morning.
And so we are going to have a little bit of prayer time. And
okay.
So what we're going to do today, we'll first go through the announcements, and we have a lot going on. Starting in September 13th. September 13th starts a lot of new stuff, all right? Especially on Sunday nights. So, Brother Chuck's going to be leading How to Study the Bible on Sundays at 5:30, and I've got some other announcements here, too, that'll be on Sundays, starting September 13th. We still need help with these prayer ministries, okay? What we have talked about, and this was kind of Vanessa's idea, and I think it's a great idea, and I mentioned it last week. What we talked about doing with the worship prayer team is this is going to be as the Lord leads you. We're not going to assign people, because that to me is, once again, we've fallen in the same trap of putting God in a box. Oh, I've got to go, you know, you may have had an awful morning, and you may need to go pray for an hour, but you may be the person who, you know, if you've had an awful morning, sometimes you're not that person. You're not the person that, you know, there's two different types of people. Some people, when you have an awful morning, you got to run and pray. And some people, when you have an awful morning like me, I got to have some time because I'll pray, but I've got to have some time to, you know, kind of cleanse myself, you know. So we're going to leave this up to your discretion. However, one thing that we're going to not do is for the next three Sundays, we're not going to have our worship prayer team. And that's because Brother Chuck, and I'm going to put it on here, has got the vision series. He's doing a vision series, and I think it's just very important that everybody is in the service listening to as he vision casts. He's taking a break from the Genesis series, and we're going to, on the 16th, 23rd, and 30th, so starting today, he's going to start casting some vision on how we're going to handle this coming year. It's a big year of transition, I believe. So we definitely still need you praying for the service, but let's do it before the service, okay? Let's do it individually, and then, September 6th, 5th or 6th, whatever day that Sunday is, that's when we'll start the worship prayer meetings back again. Don't forget the directory photos. I hope everybody's signed up. I think they probably will still have lists out in the foyer. Experiencing God. Gina's going to begin teaching some Experiencing God studies on Tuesday and Sundays. It'll be Sunday night at 5:30, and also Tuesdays for those who want to be in something else on Sunday nights. They can come on Tuesday nights. She's going to have another group, and then we have movie night. And another thing, and it doesn't apply too much to you guys, but I will be teaching this course a little bit more in depth because we'll have a little bit more time. We won't be kind of boxed in by 30, 45 minutes. I'll be teaching that on Sunday nights too, starting at 5:30 on September 16th. We'll go into a little bit more depth than what we're able to because of time constraints. And what I'll probably do is extend the discussion time a little bit. But I've had a lot of people who couldn't be in the Sunday school class say, when are you doing this for the church? And I'm like, okay, well, that's, you know, and Chuck and I talked, and that's when we're going to start. So, any other announcements? Anything I'm missing? Not much, huh? Okay. How's everybody's week going? Good so far? Everybody feel blessed?
Yes. Do we have any updates on Miss Cannon?
You know, we were just talking about that on the way in the church, and I have not heard anything. So, we need to write that down.
No, and I just ran into someone in the hall in her life, and I can't remember her name, but she went to see her yesterday.
Still in ICU, or is she in
the room? All I heard her say was she had just gone to see her, so okay. She's still in hospital, I know that, but I thought
I know. Okay. And Javi and Liz, we think Liz may be discharged today, at least that's what her thoughts was yesterday, that yep. She would be discharged today. But, of course, the baby is going to be there for quite a while. And they were hoping that, you know, maybe after a month or two, they'll be able to move her to another facility a little closer to home. But, you know, as of this morning, babies, you know, they said when she was born, the first 12 hours were the most critical. and she's been around for 24 now. And so just continue to pray. And Vanessa's going to be talking to some of you later about, you know, what we could do to help out. Okay?
Have they given you her name yet?
Drusilla?
They went with Drusilla.
They went with Drusilla, okay.
Okay, but when we were there, they were Victoria, Drusilla, we're not real sure. They hadn't made up their mind yet. So, apparently they have.
That's what said last night. And then the middle name is something like Mishael, which okay. is...
The feminine version of Meshach.
The hobby's father was Mishael, which comes from Meshach. If you study the...
Tommy's father was such a fighter, and she's been fighting. She's just such a strong fighter, so that's why they're.
And on a humorous note, she's already got more hair than Nelson does.
So. Yeah,
I had to put that in there.
Obviously, she takes after him.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, yeah. She looks just like him. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was like, my goodness.
Yeah.
Just like him.
My dad used to say the same thing about David, and he would always say, you marked him real good. And I think, hi, guys. Come on in. Can we get some chairs? So we're still praying. We're still going to believe. And the thing that we want to pray specifically, okay, we want to pray that God's will is done. And we want to pray that, that God just grants them the peace that surpasses all understanding. And that's the key. As we've talked in the past, we know that God, the real way that prayer works is that it guards your heart. And it brings you in line with God's will. You don't move God. Okay, I know, we can read some scriptures and it seems to indicate maybe, but really what's happening is God's using the test or whatever to get you to where you need to be. Because God, if you were to move God in such a sense, it would be that you were changing God's mind, and that would mean that God was wrong, and God's never wrong. And God knows what he's going to do 10,000 years before he does. Okay. So we have to be real careful to just pray that, that God's peace that surpasses all understanding guards their hearts and minds. And we read in Philippians 4 that's actually the goal of prayer. It's not to go to God and get your needs answered. Okay? I believe it's Psalm 37:4. I think it's 37:4. Maybe 34:4. It says, basically, desire, seek after the Lord, and he gives you the desires of your heart. And I kind of used to think of that as, I have desires, and if I seek after, what is it? 37:4. Can you read it for us?
Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart.
Right. So I used to kind of think of that, well, I've got desires, I've got things I want to do, and if I delight myself in the Lord, he's going to give me what I want. No. He will give you the desires that you'll have in your heart. So once again, we go from being God-centered to man-centered. And the first way is man-centered. It's I've got these desires, I've got these goals, I've got these dreams and aspirations and things I want to do. And if I'm just a good Christian, God will give that to me. No. What's going to happen is if you follow the Lord and you delight yourself in him, he's going to give you the desires that you need to have. And those desires you don't need to have, he's taking them away. Because what happens is God is a steady line, and prayer brings us into agreement with. So, what we're going to do this morning is I would like 4 volunteers to just lead us in prayer. We've got a lot of things to pray about. We still need to pray for revival in this country. We need to, I think, in the next few months, it's going to be some make or break time. And it could be within the next year, but, there's a lot of voices out there right now that say, that this next year, these next 13, 14 months, is going to be very interesting times. And they're coming from everywhere. They're coming from the Christian circles. They're coming from the Ann Grahams, the daughter of Billy Graham. They're coming from Ronnie Floyd, our president of Southern Baptist Convention. And they're coming from people like Ron Paul. And they're coming, you know, from people who aren't noted for a ministry of any kind. They're just, you know, they look at, that's what they do for a living, is they read financial tea leaves. And some of the things that are going on in the world right now, in about 3 or 4 weeks, we're really going to get into that. Once we get through where we are, we're going to go through Thyatira today. Next week, we're going to deal with Sardis and Philadelphia. And then for about 2 weeks, we're going to deal with Laodicea. And when we get to Laodicea, you'll see why we're going to spend so much time there. Because we're also going to spend some time in 2 Timothy 3, verses 1 through 9. And many of you are familiar with that passage. When I tell you about it, it says, you know, some will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits, and that's 1 Timothy 4. But the counterpart is 2 Timothy 3, where it says, you know, they will be without natural affection, they will be lovers of money, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Everybody familiar with that? Well, one thing you're going to find that's interesting, I'll give you a little snapshot, is for years and years and years, we've heard that preached as this is what the world will look like. No, this is what the world already looks like. What Paul is saying, and I can prove it through getting into the Greek and actually looking at what he says, what he's saying is that that's what the church is going to look like. So one thing you want to do, it would be real interesting for you to do this week, is take a look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. And when you read that, read it in the context of this is Paul talking about what the church looks like. And I think you will be stunned, but you will also say, you know what? That's pretty accurate of where you are.
Can you read the address again, please?
2 Timothy 3, verses 1 through 9. Yeah. And you will see that that is actually, because if you think about it, when he goes through there and he starts talking about all these things, you're like, well, the world already does that. The world's been doing that since the beginning of time. Why? That's not a shock, Paul. Why are you telling us this? Well, he's telling us this because this is a picture of the church in the end times. That it's the church full of people who are lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. It's the church that are full of people who have no natural affection. So that's the reason why we're going to spend 2 weeks in Laodicea, because we're really going to take a real good look at where we are as the church. Not First Baptist Rosharon, not Southern Baptist, but the body of Christ. Okay, those who call themselves in the body. So before we get into Thyatira, I need four people to volunteer to lead us in worship and to just pray for us. It doesn't have to be long prayers, just and let's remember our brother and sister and their precious child and their other two children. Okay, remember, you know, it's going to be a tough week. They start school this week.
No, just about a week.
Oh, we got another week.
No, Giselle starts in a week.
Giselle, okay, so it's Giselle.
24.
Okay, well, that's a little bit of a help. Okay, so who would lead us?
I can start off.
Okay, David. Who else? Okay, another David. We have another David in here? No. All right, who else? Okay, and I'll close this. All right, you go ahead.
Freedom we have together as a group to lift up our prayers to you and to be comfortable to be able to do this and save you this comfort. There's so many prayers out there that need to be answered more. We just lift each one to you. There's no spoken, and we have a word of wisdom for those that give us struggles. I just ask that you give them peace and comfort. Doctors, the wisdom to take care of this new life, and we just pray for the strength of this baby to continue to carry on. So, love that you have us, give us a great sure. Father, again, we thank you for the blessings you give us each day. Father, we pray for our country as many perilous times are here and more are to come, Father. Help us as Christians to prepare for these times, and trusting in you and holding fast to you, drawing near to you, Father, and help us to walk with you And as we know, our country has strayed from you. And Father, help us to hold on to you. Even if it's a remnant, your word says that you will be with us at all times. And I pray for Bobby and Liz and for little Drusilla, Father, I lift them up to you now as we saw the miracle of life, so tiny and so small, but yet all the parts are moving, just as you've created, as you knit that baby together in the mother's womb. Father, we see a miracle in front of us. We pray for Giselle and Anastasia as they are wondering what's going on. We pray for them and those that are taking care of them. Father, we pray for our country. We pray for our church, Father, as Nelson has mentioned, that God help us not to be lovers of self in the church and lovers of this and that and think that, okay, we're okay and everybody else is bad. Father, help us to have a burden for the lost. And I pray for a drawing, that the Holy Spirit would draw the lost unto you. And Father, that we would be ready to be witnesses for you day in and day out, Father. And again, I thank you for this class. And I thank you for Brother Nelson and his heart. Walk with us, and Father, and we want to search you and be with you, Father, in Jesus' name.
Sweet Jesus, we just come before you, Lord, humbly at your throne. We lift Javi and Elizabeth, Giselle, Anastasia, the whole family, Lord. We just lift them up, lay them at your feet, Lord God, praising you for your decisions, Lord. We don't understand your plan, but we trust you. Lord, we know that you've got Drusilla in the palm of your hand, that you are the great physician, the great I am, Jehovah Rapha, Lord God. We just pray Jesus' blood over them, and we ask that you would just day by day, hour by hour, minute by minute, just continue to breathe life in this precious world. We just thank you, Lord, so much for your sovereignty, for your justice, and for just bestowing your love and mercy on us, Lord God, and on this precious family. Lord, I pray for Linda Martinez, Lord.
Yes.
I ask, Lord, that you would give the doctors the knowledge to know what's going on and how to fix this problem, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that you would just... you would hear the cries from the hearts of the people in this room, in this very church, Lord, that have deep hurts and deep concerns, and they don't know how to voice them, Lord. But you know what they are. You're the God of all comfort. You're a wonderful, wonderful counselor, Lord, and I pray that we would come to you and that we would lay our burdens at your feet and that you would comfort us as only you can be. Lord, above all, I pray that we would be willing vessels to do your will, to seek the lost, that you would give us the words to speak, that we would be the examples to these people. Lord, this precious young man that I met yesterday is so confused. My heart just broke as he thinks homosexuality is how he can get attention. It just broke my heart, Lord. I pray, Lord, for that young man. I pray that you would just put someone in his life that would just open his eyes, that the Holy Spirit would draw him to you, Lord, and that he would turn from his ways and love you. Lord, I pray for Brother Trek today as he gives us the message. Lord, I just pray that all of our hearts would be open to receive what you have given him to preach on. I pray, Lord, that we would be obedient, that we would have loving kindness one towards another, and that we would have a harmonious atmosphere and heart, and that we would do as a church what you would have called us to do, Lord, and that is reach lost souls. I thank you for Brother Nelson and Vanessa. I thank you for this class, and I thank you for this ministry. Lord, I thank you so much for being such an amazing, awesome God.
Yes.
And allowing me to serve you. The fact that you would even think that I am capable of that is just amazing to me. Because I'm so not worthy of it. And I just praise you for it. Your mercy and your grace in my life. In Jesus' precious name.
Father, we are just so thankful, Sister Dana said, for your sovereignty. Lord, we acknowledge your sovereignty in all of our lives. Lord, you are God and you do what you will. And Father, I pray that as we pray and as we grow closer in the bonds of Christian love and as we grow closer to you in our individual walks, that we would truly learn to delight ourselves in you. And Father, that you would make us a blank slate. Father, that's our prayer today, that you would just create in us a blank slate, Father, on which you can write the desires on our heart that you would will that we have. And then, Father, I know, according to your word, that you promised to give us those desires, Father, when they're granted by you, and that you promised to make our way straight. So, Lord, I just lift up this class to you, and I lift up this this group of believers to you, Father, this small group. And, Lord, I thank you for the bonds of Christian love. Father, I thank you for Javi and Liz, Lord, and Giselle and Anastasia and little Drusilla, Lord. I lift up that family to you who are precious in your sight. And Lord, I pray you will grant us wisdom on how to minister to this family in their time of need. And Father, help us to do it in such a way that it is a witness to those looking in, Father, from the outside. That they would truly look and go, wow, that's something that I don't have. People who aren't my family care about me so deeply. Father, we thank you for the fellowship of the Spirit above all things, Lord. We give you praise for who you are. And Lord, we do lift up Brother Chuck to you as he casts the vision for this church. Lord, I pray that it would touch every heart, Father. Every heart that's here today, everyone within earshot, Lord, I pray that it would just speak to us in a new way and prepare us for what the future holds. And so, Father, we give you thanks today in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 That was good worship time. So, our scripture for the week, for the Word of God, is living and active, sharpening two-edged sword, piercing division of the soul, spirits and joints and marrow, discerning the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. Now, what's interesting about this is that this is Jesus. Okay, because Jesus is the Word of God, right? That's what we learned last week. That's what Jesus was trying to get across to which church? Remember? Pergamum. Okay, the church of Pergamum. He was trying to get across that I'm the Word of God. And we see this from other scriptures. All right. And this kind of needs to be our theme. You know, we've got a lot of themes that we need to have, but this is another one. And as we get into looking at Thyatira today, what you're going to see is a lot of paganism and falsehood that has been injected into Christianity over the years. And this is why this is very important. Is because, you know, let me get this a little bit out of focus, I think. There we go. I think that's a little better. Because unless we have something that can actually cut down to the quick and get down to the root of it, we can be led astray. We can be deceived. And this is one of the reasons that when the Reformation happened and Martin Luther screamed sola scriptura, in other words, in scripture alone, this is one of the big divisions between Catholics and Protestants. As a matter of fact, I still see it on blog sites and other things today. I still read people, you know, say, hey, it's not sola scriptura, you got to have tradition. But yet we know, you know, what Jesus said. Traditions of man are nothing, okay? That's what the Pharisees had done, had interjected their traditions. And so we have to stick with what we know, and we know the Word of God. So as we go into week five, we're going to be looking at, and that should be circled Thyatira. I forgot to do my circle. So we're actually in Thyatira today, and we're just going to look at Thyatira. That's all we're going to do. Akeser, that is the modern name of Thyatira. That is, right now, if you were to drive on a road from Istanbul back to Izmir, remember, Izmir was Smyrna. So these are actual cities in Turkey today. Akeser is kind of a no-name city, right? It's really, It's, I don't know, Centerville on the road to Dallas. All right, you know, everybody pass through Centerville? Okay, I was going to say Madisonville, but the Buc-ee's is there and everybody
that's right.
So that wouldn't be too appropriate. So, but what it was known for in that day is its dyes, scarlet purple dyes. That's, if you needed to get some scarlet or purple colored clothing, chances are the dyes came from this town, okay, the town of Thyatira. So, the name, as we've been looking, the name, it means continual sacrifice. Now, this is real important when we look at the prophetic fulfillment. This is one, once again, the amazing things that God has done in just naming towns and putting churches where He will. But here are the title, the words of the Son of God, who has eyes like a flame of fire and whose feet are like burnished bronze. So we see again a description. We saw this kind of description in Revelation chapter 1. But now we see the feet are like burnished bronze. Remember, the bronze, it's tried. All right, and that's basically what it's. It's walked through the flames. These feet have walked through the flames. They've been tried. They're burnished. Okay, they're flame tested, and they've come through. All right, eyes like a flame of fire. Now, if you think about a flame of fire, what a house catches on fire, or you know, what survives fire? What's the only thing really that's, when a house burns completely to the ground, what's left? Charcoal, ashes, and what?
Bricks
and metal and foundation, okay? So stuff, you know, this is what Jesus is saying here about himself is, you know, let's go back to Hebrews 4:12. I'm the discerner of the intentions of the heart. So what he's saying to this church specifically is, y'all are doing a real good job of building your house, okay? And it looks real good to people on the outside. But when my flame of fire hits it, we're going to determine exactly what's in it. Because we had a house fire, and only our kitchen really, I mean, it did $180,000 worth of damage, but only the kitchen was really toasted because fire ran out of oxygen and smoldered. But we've all seen those houses burnt down to the ground. And nothing that's not solid, if it's not metal, concrete, you know, or bricks, it's gone. That heat will destroy it. And that's what Jesus is saying. Guys, I know exactly where you are. And nothing's going to survive the flame of my judgment. And that's what he says to the Corinthians. That's what Paul says to Corinthians. You know, let each man be careful how he builds his house, because the day will decide it. You know, it's going to run through the fire, and all this wood, hay, and stubble that we build up, and some of it is stuff that we think is important. It's really wood, hay, and stubble. It's going to get burned.
That's what we stand before Christ.
And that's the Bema Seat judgment, right? So that is what God is saying. That's what Jesus is saying here, is that I'm going to judge, all right? It's commendation. Believe it or not, they did have a commendation. I know your works, your charity, and your service. Okay, you think back. It kind of sounds a little bit like the Ephesus, doesn't it? I know your works. You're doing good stuff, all right? Your faith, your patience. And this is interesting. He says your works. He says that twice. He says, I know your works. And charity and service and faith and patience and your works. He might be trying to emphasize something there. Even in a commendation, he's trying to emphasize your works. All right. And the last to be more than the first. So that's verse 19. So when we do good things, we need to understand that we have a tendency to say, oh, well, my salvation is not a works-based salvation. And that is absolutely correct. Salvation is through grace of God alone. It's a gift. But, as the book of James points out, this is important.
He says faith with works.
Faith with works. Matter of fact, that is why the book of James was so slow to be canonized. It was one of the last books in the New Testament canon. Because of that seeming ugh, this doesn't fit with the Pauline doctrine, the Pauline theology of grace. So there seems to be a conflict. And it actually took them a while, a few councils, to figure out, okay, wait, we get it. Okay, even though the early church got it, by the 4th century, they were already starting to go, what's going on here? Well, they do have a condemnation. They tolerate paganism, and they allow paganism to influence them. So this is what he says. I have this against you. You tolerate that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, and is teaching and seducing my servants to practice sexual immorality and to eat food sacrificed to idols. Well, there's the first part. You tolerate. And in the Greek, what that word tolerate means is you allow one to do as they wish. You don't restrain them. You leave them alone. And if we think about how we are in the modern church, isn't it kind of the way we are? I mean, we don't want to rock the boat. We don't want to create waves. If we see somebody in sin or they're even false teaching, we're not going to say anything.
They do it under the label of grace, though. That's the issue.
Yes, sir. That is the issue. That is the big issue, as far as I'm concerned, is we do it under the label of grace. Okay? But Jesus' letter to Thyatira says that, and as we explore who Jezebel is and what he's talking about, we see that, you know what? There is a place for grace. There is. And there's also a place for dealing with false teaching. And there's a place for dealing with sin in grace and love. Okay, Galatians 6:1 is a classic verse on that. If any of you see a brother or sister overtaken in a fault, does the next say, anybody go do it? No. It says, you who are spiritual, which is an odd, I mean, we kind of use that term today and we kind of think, well, that's kind of a flaky term, but that's what Paul said. You who are spiritual, go and seek to restore them in a spirit of meekness, lest you yourselves stumble or fall. Okay? So, if we have a brother or sister that's caught in a sin, let's say they're lying, or, you know, and we know that they're lying, and or they're into this or they're into that, and we just know that they're not behaving, all right, according to the scripture, and it's bringing disgrace upon the church. To me, that's where church discipline gets separated. I mean, we are not the sin police, okay? But when it starts to bring discredit upon the name of Christ, because it's a public sin, it's something that's happening in public. Okay, let's say we've got somebody who is bad-mouthing the pastor or the church leadership. That's bringing disgrace to the name of Christ, and that's the time when people in leadership have to go, you know what, brother? I love you, but you're sinning. Because for one thing, the scripture tells you to go to that person and to not sit there and spread rumors and do all of this stuff. Okay? So we have to be very careful. But what had happened by, you know, as we look into the church history and what was happening in Thyatira, they began to tolerate because of grace. Okay?
Kind of makes you think of look the other way. The church might just kind of look the other
way. Right, yeah, and they were. But in Thyatira, they were actually starting to incorporate it. Okay, but you had a remnant there, because remember, you had a commendation. You had a remnant there, and we even see that later on. Well, actually, right here, to the rest of you. So we already see, hold on one second, Herman. We already see two groups. We got a group that is incorporating paganism in the church at Thyatira, and we got another group that's going, wait, what are we doing here? Okay, who do not hold to this teaching, who have not, now this is real important, we're going to actually expound upon this, who have not learned what some call the deep things of Satan. Go ahead, Carmen.
Brother Johnson, not only does it hurt the church, but it also brings reproach upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
That's right.
And
that's right. And it is tough. If you were to go to someone who was, let's say they were spreading rumors about our pastor. Okay, let's say that they had a disagreement and they were being vicious about it and talking about it behind their back. What would be the number one thing they would probably say to you if you were to go and tell them, hey, you're sinning? What would they say you're doing?
Judging.
You're judging. And then they'd probably throw Matthew 7 out at you, right? Mm-hmm. Judge not that you be not judged.
Mind your own business.
Mind your own business, right.
It's the word of God that's doing the judging.
Exactly. And we see that, you know, the classic scriptures that give us permission to judge in the sense of being a fruit inspector are Matthew 7, believe it or not, in context. Everybody wants to read that first verse and then they drop it. Nobody wants to read the rest of it that says, well, as long as you don't have a big log in your eye, you can remove the speck from your brother's eye. Because Jesus says that. If you're not being a hypocrite about it, you can get in there and dig for that speck. That's the key. And that goes with Galatians 6:1. If you're not spiritual, don't go digging in somebody's eye. And 1 Corinthians 5 says, don't judge those in the outside. If they're outside the church, God judges them already. You need to lead them to Christ. You need to point them to Christ. Judging their sin, guess what? Their sin's already judged. The wrath of God still resides on them. All right? John 3:36. How much more can you do with your little judgment if the wrath of God still resides on them? Can you really do much with judging them? No. That's why when we talk about people who are caught in a sin, if they are non-Christians, like you were talking about the man struggling with homosexuality, if they're not Christians, you know what? They're condemned already. That little thing that they're doing, and I call it little because in the grand scheme of things, homosexuality is a little thing, and cheating on your wife's a little thing, and taking a candy bar from the store without paying for it's a little thing. Okay? It's not those things that send you to hell. So we have a backwards idea of what salvation is when we think that way. As if the person who may be doing the work of Mother Teresa, if they don't know Christ, they may be the greatest person in the world. Guess what? The wrath of God still sits there. We have to keep a perspective. Okay? So good point, Brother Herman. And it brings reproach to the name of our Lord. All right? And so we have to always be ready to look at false teaching.
Wouldn't another word for that tolerate the compromise?
Yes, and compromise. And that's what we're going to look at. The reward for obeying is their reward, a place in the millennial kingdom. They're going to be given a place to rule. And there's Daniel 7:27. And the kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High. All right? And then here's another one. Truly, I said, this is Jesus saying, in the new world, in other words, in the millennial kingdom, when the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne. Has that happened yet? No, but it will happen one day. You who have followed me will sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And we see other scriptures that Jesus says, you're going to judge the nation. Don't you know that you shall judge angels? Okay, so that's the promise for obeying. Is remember, and at the end of this, we're going to put all of these together. We're going to look at all the promises. We're going to look at all the commendations and all the condemnations and all the things that we got to think about and how it applies to the church. And you're going to see a holistic view. And it's really cool when you put it all together and you go, wow. So this is how we should be acting. Okay, this is what's waiting for us. And finally, he says, I will give him the morning star. And we see in 2 Peter 1:19, it says, when the morning star rises in your heart. And the morning star is Jesus. Can somebody read 2 Peter 1:19 real quick? 2 Peter 1:19. David, are you getting there?
Yes.
Go ahead.
And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, which you will do well to pay attention as to the lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your heart.
Okay. So this is a process. But one day the day is going to dawn. And the morning star is going to rise in our heart. Okay? So it's prophetic fulfillment. Remember, the name means continuing sacrifice or continual sacrifice. That's the name of Thyatira. Well, it represents the medieval papacy. It represents the church from about 600 to the Reformation. Now, any of you who have done church history, you think of this period of time as just probably, good heavens, awful. You know, many of the popes were good people, but many of them were also had illegitimate children. And, you know, the Catholic Church has finally come around to admitting some of that. They had illegitimate children. There was a couple of popes there that were actually the illegitimate children of other popes. You know, there's one pope, I believe, who was 9 or 11 or something like that. And it was a familial appointment. If you really get to the nitty-gritty of the history there, you're thinking, wow, this has got to be the worst time ever. But what you got to remember is, remember, there was a commendation. Right? There was a commendation. So, this period of time is represented by the personage of Jezebel. But it's and we're going to look at who Jezebel was in just a second. Its application to us as believers is guard the doctrines of the church. Be an apologeticist. What does that mean? If I say be an apologeticist, what does that mean to you? Say it louder, Lance.
To be able to defend your faith.
Be able to defend the faith. The apologetics is basically the act of warring. Okay? It's the act of being able to answer questions. And you know, when we read that in the scripture, be able to give an answer to anybody who asks for the hope that's in you. Now, can you give an answer if you don't know your scripture? If you're not spending time in the Word of God, can you give an answer? If you're not doing the hard work, remember what we talked about. This is hard work. Right? And in my class last week, which I'm sorry, I still haven't gotten it on there, the crash course on sharing your faith, the very first thing I say, what did I say, David? It's hard work. Part of our problem with the church today is everybody wants to think the church is it's easy. Hey, come as you are, we can do whatever we want. No. It's a country club for Christians. But what we have to understand, and this is what Jesus is telling Thyatira, is this is hard work. It takes time to set a time aside and open that Bible and read what you may not understand and hunt for those answers and then leave it up to the Lord and spend some time in prayer about it and go, Lord, I don't understand this. I'm going to write it in my journal, ? I have no clue what this verse means. And I'm going to pray about it. And guess what? Sometime when I'm driving down the road or I'm at the supermarket or wherever I am, I'm at work, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, God gives you that answer. And those of you who have been benefactors to that know how great of a testimony that is, because it may have been the day before. It could have been a year before. Wow. Thank you, Lord. I was struggling with an answer one time back in 94, and I prayed about it for 6 months, and the Lord gave me that answer in December of 94, and I've been praying about it since May of 94, and then I couldn't realize I just couldn't understand how stupid I had been. How did I not see this? Well, because God wanted to take me through a process. So we have to be an apologeticist. We have to, as Christians, have that mindset. That this is just not easy. This is not just something that we should take lightly. This is important. Now, what was the description of Christ? He's got his eyes are what? A flame of what? Fire. So, what basically God is saying is, and through Jesus Christ, he's saying is, you may play church real well, are you going to be able to survive the fire? And if you're an apologeticist, you can survive the fire. But the most important thing here is that when you run into those people, and you're going to run into them, you need to be able to give an answer. Okay, and it needs to be a scriptural answer. And in order to do that, you have to know the word. So Jezebel, who was she? Everybody remember who Jezebel was in 1 Kings? Kind of gave her and Elijah, did they get along?
No.
No, they did not get along. She married Ahab, and this kind of sealed a good arrangement between Israel and Phoenicia. And her claim to fame was she tried to kill all the prophets of God. That was her deal, was to kill the prophets. And she also incorporated pagan rituals into Judaism. And we see in verse 21 that she refuses to repent of her sexual immorality. Well, that was because what the Babylonian paganism is. Everybody read, and they did not remove the high places, you know, because pagans always worshipped on a hill. Okay, y'all know what these high places were, the groves? Well, what they were was they would take the trees that are on top of these hills and they would carve them into phallic symbols. Okay? And that's what they would have, sexual symbols on top of these hills, and that's what they would worship. So whenever we see these kings that they bring revival, but they didn't remove the high places, that's what they're talking about. They left those on top of the hill. Okay? And that's what Babylonianism, because remember, all corruption and all paganism starts in Babylon. You go back to the root in Genesis 10, Genesis 11, all false religion starts in Babylon. Okay? So you have to be real careful when you're reading the prophecies. As we get into Revelation 17 and 18, as we look over in Jeremiah 51, we have to be very careful when we read into Babylon that we don't just say, automatically go, well, this is the country of Babylon. No. Okay, Zechariah 5 is a classic example that we'll look into. Babylon is also an idea. Okay, Babylon is a concept. It's the source of all false religion. So what we see is she's going to be thrown into a sick bed. Those that commit adultery with her will be thrown into great tribulation, and I will strike her children dead. All right, the children here being the idea of paganism and all of its offshoots. So this was the worst time in the period of Old Testament history under Ahab and Jezebel. And remember, in 2 Kings 9, she was killed by Jehu. Remember, Jehu comes riding in. He says, throw her down. They just threw her down. And what happened? It was fulfilled by the prophet. Exactly. The only thing left was her skull, palm of her hands, and her feet. All right? So almost done here. The deep things of Satan. And this is what I'm going to spend a couple of minutes on. Spirit says expressingly, in the latter times, some will depart from the faith, devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and teachings of demons. 1 Corinthians 10:12, Paul gets a little bit more direct. No, he's saying, I imply that what pagans sacrifice they offer to demons and not to God. And finally, in Deuteronomy 32, so this is Old Testament and New Testament. So here's Paul and here's Moses. They sacrifice to demons. And then finally, here's John in Revelation. Okay? The rest of mankind were not killed. They did not repent of the works of their hands or give up worshiping demons. What we need to know from this is that all false religion, if it is not originated in the Word of God, it's a doctrine of a demon. It's meant to deceive. Okay? So the application of us believers is guard against the doctrines of the church. Oh, what is it doing now? Okay. So, one last thing here. Structure change. Remember how we had the promise, or the he who has an ear, let him hear, and then we had the promise? Well, starting with Thyatira, you're going to see that flipped. We'll talk about that later. All right. But there's a reason for it. Remember, everything in the Word of God is there for a reason, and it's put in such a way for a reason. And that's where you have to go dig the gold. So we, in the old first three letters, we had the promise, then he who has an ear. I'm sorry. That was the way it was at first, and here is the way it is now. We'll have the promise, then we'll have he who has an ear, let him hear. Okay. So the takeaway today is if we look at, we talked a little bit about this last week, is we talked a little bit about like the origin of the Christmas tree and stuff. Now, I'm not going to go out and say that, I mean, we put up a Christmas tree. We've changed the meaning, okay? We've kind of co-opted what the devil intended to do and we've made it into something good. But we also at the same time need to be wise and understand that this is the origin of it. Okay, it doesn't ever hurt to know the history, you know, because if you don't know history, you're what? Doomed to repeat it, right? So we need to remember, and as we examine the way our church is, just our local church, our church in general, We need to be very careful about understanding the history of where things come from. And we need to be very careful in applying the scripture to our church life so that we don't incorporate something as traditions are fine. We have traditions here, and traditions are okay. But it's when we elevate that in our heart to the level of scripture, that's where we can get in trouble. Okay, who can think of an example, maybe? What's an example?
A tradition.
Of something that maybe in the church, maybe not this church, another church you've been to, or a church you know about, where they have elevated something to almost religious, scriptural levels that really is not found in the Word of God.
Christmas play.
Okay? Mm-hmm. Okay. Because you just got to do that, right? Or an Easter, an Easter play.
It takes precedent of that church for the next 3 months until it's done, because it's the biggest deal. I've been there.
Perfect example. Yeah, we have too. Not that there's anything wrong with it. Okay?
Sunday school.
VBS. Not that there's anything wrong with these things. When we were looking at planning a church back in 2002, and I'll say it was this church. Okay, some of you might have been here in 2002, some of you wouldn't. I was specifically told, because we wanted to do a small group church, a cell group, where we didn't have Sunday school. We would meet at like 10 on a Sunday morning and go to about noon, have a two-hour celebration worship time, and then we would have small groups meeting at home. I was specifically told about the leadership of this church at the time. Do not say, and this was told to me by the former association pastor, director, Olin Bowles, do not say that you're not having Sunday school if you want support from them. And I was like, what? Sunday school is an invention of man. There ain't nothing wrong with it. There really isn't. That's why I'm here right now. If I thought something was wrong with it, I wouldn't be here. But it's an invention of man. The key is to have a small group of people that meet sometime, you know, and to grow each other up in the Lord. But Sunday school is, you know, that only goes back a couple hundred years. But when you have elevated Sunday school to something that if you're not doing it, you're not being Christian, now you're adding something that's not in the gospel. I mean, most of us, if I were to dress you in a toga or whatever, you know, and take you back to the first century church and give you the gift of being able to understand the language, you would not recognize church. You really wouldn't. And I would dare say for most of you here, y'all would do just fine, probably all of you looking at the faces. But if we were to take this entire church back to the first century, I would say after about a month, we'd probably lost about half of our group. And I'm not joking. Because it was just that radically different. They expected so much more of you. Okay? It wasn't the country club. All right? So that's the takeaway from today. Scripture for the week. 1 Corinthians 10:20. This is important because I want you guys to really start looking at Christianity and start looking at other denominations. And start looking at the histories of where these things began. What is the source? Okay? And one thing I did put on here, if you know about Catholic Church history, the doctrine of the Mass, what is the Mass? It's a continuing sacrifice. It's the way it's labeled in Catholic Church, am I right? It's a continuing ritual sacrifice because they believe that at that time you're re-crucifying Jesus. It's the real transubstantiation. The real blood, the real flesh. Okay? It's called a continuing sacrifice. Well, it's amazing that Thyatira means continuing sacrifice, continual sacrifice. So you're basically re-crucifying Jesus over and over and over again every time you have the Mass. Well, that is the period of time when the Mass became what it is today. Okay? So if you go to a Catholic Mass, you're actually participating in what they view as the re-crucifixion of Jesus. Believe it or not. That's a little bit more detailed than that, but that's the nuts and the bolts. Now, we know Jesus, according to the Scripture, Jesus was crucified how many times?
Once
and for all. Period. No more. All right. So, everybody remember to keep Liz and Javi in your prayers and the baby. And let's close in prayer. Gracious Father, we are so thankful for your letter to Thyatira. Father, we're thankful that you have chosen to speak to us through these churches, and you speak to us individually each time we open the letter in Revelation. Father, you have something new for us. You teach us something. So Father, we're thankful. Lord, I'm thankful that you have put in there how important it is to guard against false doctrine, because Father, it is a corruption of all that you did. It seeks to corrupt and to take away from Christ. And Lord, that's the last thing we want. We don't ever want that in our lives. So help us to guard and protect us, Lord. So Father, as we go forth today, I pray you would just give us an attitude of worship. Just give us a spirit of worship, Father, and lead us into you. And show us what you have for us. In Christ's name, amen.